It's sometimes rather difficult to believe when you come down here on Columbia Street in front of what was the BC Penitentiary that this was the site of the first camp in this area. This is where the Royal Engineers had their camp while they were doing most of their work in British Columbia. The Royal Engineers were in BC from about 1858 until 1863. For a short period of about 5 years, and during that time they did a tremendous amount to laying out what we now know as British Columbia. They were heavily involved with surveying, with all the roads. A lot of things that we take for granted today were the foundations for these things were set by the Royal Engineers. As you can see from the cairn this put up, showing that this was the site of the Royal Engineers camp where it all began. Up until very recently, this was the BC Penitentiary, and all of this has changed now. As I said, it's difficult when you have the traffic going by to realize that this used to be a rather serene and lovely looking military camp with very interesting looking homes. We have to be careful of the traffic here. It's a rather loud, noisy spot to be. But looking across to the river from here, you can get the very easily get the idea of why the Royal Engineers picked this spot. It is a beautiful location with a marvelous view up the river, and I think it really gives us some idea of the foresight of these men that they chose this spot and the view. This was the camp until 1863 when they left. It later became the penitentiary, and up until just very recently in 1980, it was closed down. I think the history of the Royal Engineers in this area and what they did to develop the Lower Mainland, Fraser Valley, and BC is one of the most important chapters in the history of British Columbia.
Now, this program on the Royal Engineers, obviously because of the amount of work which they did during their stay in what is now British Columbia, because of the vast amount of work that they did, there's no way we can completely cover it all. So we're going to give you a survey look at some of the things that they did while they were here and a few of the things that you can go and see that are reminders of their short visit with us. Now, gold was discovered on the Thompson and Fraser Rivers. It brought a great many people to the area. And in a very short time, Governor Douglas, who we see here in this etching taking the oath of office from Judge Begbie, realized that he needed help in controlling the miners, in setting up law and order, establishing a form of civilization, if you will, in the area. And he contacted the British House. It was agreed that he needed help in the colony, and the Royal Engineers were sent out. Now, in the course of events, the Royal Engineers were in a great many activities. Probably one thing that they are known the best for in this area is their work along the Fraser River in regards to the working on the Caribou Road, working on the other trails to the interior, the trails along what is now the Southern Trans-Provincial, over to Princeton and over into the Okanagan Valley. The Fraser River had been the route for a great many people who traveled north and south in our province, but there wasn't a road, and the Royal Engineers were the first to really begin to establish a communications route along this very wild river. Now, when the Royal Engineers arrived, and one of their first duties was to establish a capital, and the choice for capital was New Westminster. And the photograph that you see on the screen now, while this is not the New Westminster site, this is the type of landscape that they came into. A very densely forested area. In one account that is available for the public to read, they talk about the fact that it took many, many days to cut the lines of vision so that they could go about their surveying. A very difficult area to work in. And this is the type of thing that sat in dealing with New Westminster now. This is the type of thing you see on your screen that the Royal Engineers would have come into in the new Westminster area when beginning to clear it and lay it out to be the capital and the center for all of their activities. I included this one because this gives you a very good idea. This is taken right in the new Westminster area, and it gives you a very clear illustration of the sizes of the trees that were in this area. Now, the man who was in charge of the Columbia Detachment of the Royal Engineers was Colonel Richard Clement Moody. This man was well known in the Royal Engineers, and he was sent out here because he was both a taskmaster, he was a tough soldier, and he was also an artist at heart and had tremendous vision, which he improved in other locations during his career. Now, one of the things that Moody did very quickly when he came out here was to map the area. And in this map, if you look carefully at your screen, at the center of the screen, you can see where the Fraser River comes down and it runs out in its various channels. You'll see one area right in the center, it's marked proposed site of the capital. That is the site of the city of New Westminster. Now, the Royal Engineers, while in the New Westminster area, established their camp. The Royal Engineers camp, as you find references to in a great many articles and books. This camp area was established on the site of what is now the BC Penitentiary site. Now, the penitentiary is no more, so then we will have to begin to call it a different site in probably the near future. But this photograph shows the pen site and the Royal Engineers camp, and the camp was formerly used by these men from 1859 until 1863. In this photograph, you can see the number of buildings, the barracks, they had everything that they needed in this one location. Now, one thing I want you to notice in this picture, because at the end of this particular program, we will refer to it again, I want you to notice the flagpole just to the right of center down there, reasonably close to the river, and you can see a white marker next to it. That is one of the survey points that the Royal Engineers used on the mainland. That is the number one point from which the surveys all came out. And if we wait until the end of the program, we have a picture for you of the site, and it's a place you can go to now. It's recently been remarked, and it's because of that, it's quite an interesting aspect to look at this photograph and see where that marker is, and then you can go to it today. A couple of pictures here showing the types of uniforms that were worn by the Royal Engineers while they were on duty here in British Columbia. The varieties of uniforms. You can imagine that they must have cast quite a dashing figure in a colony that was made up of gold miners and people who were really out to seek their fortune and had really no idea of fashion, if you want to consider it that. These men were well known, and we find in a number of old articles that people often refer to the colors of their uniforms and how they made such a nice contrast with the drab everyday existence. Now, this rather picture shows the Royal Engineers and the gold escort. They never did really get too involved with this, but it does show that they did have that romantic feeling about them, and this was captured by artists over the years. Now, just a couple more maps for you to see of the area, and just to give you an idea of what the Royal Engineers did. Again, looking closely at your screen, you'll see that there is a definite balance and pattern to that map. You can, if you look right up the center, you can see that there's a center stalk, and then you come off the sides of it, and you can see the angular streets on either side all perfectly balanced. This was laid out by Moody. The city was laid out to be this way. And there's a project in the works right now to put together a formal program on the entire way that the city was laid out. There were crescents, as you can see here, angled streets, a very formal feeling to this Victorian community, something which Moody had brought with him from the old country. Now, this is an old map. We can see the layout of the city in it, And if you examine the map again, you will see that the angular streets are evident in this one. Now this particular map on the right side of your screen shows a large open area. Part of that was Queen's Park, and part of that is the penitentiary site of today, the site of the Royal Engineers Camp. Now this aerial photograph, I think we can see it clear enough here. If you look carefully at it, you can pick out the angular streets, you can pick out Queen's Park and the penitentiary grounds on the right. The city today is very much like it was when it was laid out by the Royal Engineers in 1859 to 1863. Now this is a very early New Westminster. This is in the early 1860s. The buildings that we should note in this particular picture are, first of all, the grouping of buildings at the center of the photo. In today's New Westminster, that would be 6th Street and Columbia. Those were the government offices, and in there they took care of all some of the printing. A lot of the other printing was done at the camp, but they had some printing facilities here. Land registry, the post office, the part of the assay office, later for a very short period of time the mint, and that was located in that location. The building just to the right of center, up in the trees a bit more, is Holy Trinity Cathedral, an early church, and a building that the Royal Engineers were involved with its construction. A little closer view of that 6 and Columbia location and the government offices. You can see if you have any knowledge at all about the way that the British military worked when they laid out camps, you will recognize that this is very much the type of thing that they did in other places in the world. As they needed another building, they would add the building and connect them together. And this particular complex is 3 across here in the front, and we're told it also went a row backwards. But this contained their offices. This was the governmental center of activity as it was laid out by the Royal Engineers. And that same building showing some of the staff on hand there, and you can see the signs are post office and assay office and land registry. Another view, a little different angle, but again you can see that those offices are in the center, you can see the church. New Westminster is growing in this picture, you can see the land's been cleared. But this was what the Royal Engineers laid out. It's what they set out to accomplish among the long list of other things that they did while they were in the area of the province of British Columbia. You should notice from this one the type of landscape they had to work with. It was extremely rugged. A number of gullies ran down across the city, and so it took men of great vision to see that a formal capital could be laid out amidst all this turmoil. Believe it or not, in this picture you'd be looking right up Columbia Street. We're down about the corner of Columbia and 8th Street, and you're looking up along the street, looking at the buildings. The thing you should notice is the ground cover, the way there's huge stumps and trees right down in the foreground of the picture. Very difficult area to get around at this time. I mentioned Holy Trinity Cathedral, a little closer picture of that. The Royal Engineers were involved with its construction. Another church that a couple of Royal Engineers were involved with was St. Mary the Virgin Anglican Church in Sapperton. Now on the map you saw earlier, I mentioned a crescent, and you could see that crescent was out in the area of New Westminster, where Columbia and McBride meet, out in that area. This was Albert Crescent or Prospect Park. Albert Crescent, of course, named after the consort Queen Victoria. And this is an early view of that, and if you look very carefully at this picture, you can see that there are formal gardens down in front. This was to be a formal circular park with a band shell looking out over the river. And right now we're looking up the river toward the Golden Ears, which Colonel Moody described as the jewels in the crown of Queen Victoria, and up to the Fraser Valley, which was to be called Glen Albert. Now this is a later picture of Queen's Park, but the area of Queen's Park was laid out by the Royal Engineers to be a park location. And Colonel Moody is said to have reported in an early letter that he felt that the entire hill, not just Queen's Park, but what a marvelous park the entire hill would have made. He was a man of extreme vision. He knew what had to be done, and he tried to keep the community as relaxed within the context of the area he was building it. He wanted it to be, first of all, a formal capital city, but he also wanted it to have the trees and the landscape of what he knew from the old country to be a very pleasurable place to be. Now, one other item we really can't forget is Irving House, and the Royal Engineers, under private contract to Captain William Irving, built this home for the captain here in New Westminster. Captain Irving was not a member of the Royal Engineers. He was a riverboat captain, a private businessman, but some of the best carpentry talent available and house building talent available would have been in the Royal Engineers, and so Captain Irving acquired their services, and of course Irving House remains today in the city as a historic center. I mentioned at the outset of this portion of this program that the road up the Fraser Canyon was one of their major accomplishments. Royal Engineers were involved in this project from its beginning to its end, and this is an early view showing the road going up part of the canyon. Now, one way to find out about people in your community, and in this case to find remembrances of the Royal Engineers, is to go to the cemetery in Sapperton. And in this case we have the oldest stone in the area, and that the grave of James Digby, a Royal Engineer. Now go back out to the camp for a minute in a few pictures here, and I think that we should concentrate on this because there is a great deal of discussion about the site to do with the BC Penitentiary property. And in this case we are looking up again across that site, and you can see the buildings in the background. This man has the wagon is down on the road in front of the Royal Engineers camp. And so that this area of the camp is extremely important, not necessarily because of the BC Penitentiary being on it, although that site was used as a BC Pen site for a great many years. Actually, the pen was built in 1878. The site is of greater importance because it was the site of the Royal Engineers. The engineers, while they were here, worked on communications of all type, printing, the early weather reporting, all the surveying. They brought with them other skills, tremendous skills of, first of all, architectural skills, carpentry and finished work. They were well known for their talents in the theater, in music, drama. And after the detachment left in 1863, a great many of these men took an active part in the development of all the various aspects and the social and cultural aspects of the city of New Westminster. The government house which they developed stayed on for a few years, but it wasn't used. Once the capital left New Westminster, there was no need for the house to be in use at this point, and eventually it was torn down. A rather imposing building though. This one stood up on the hill out close to the camp, and this was to be the governor's residence, in that New Westminster was to be the capital of the colony. Now this is a rather interesting photograph. We're looking out by where the sawmills were in Sapperton, and looking up in the background there we can see the BC Penitentiary, so that this picture is obviously from this particular view in the 1880s. But if we look very closely in front of the penitentiary building, which we see at the top of the hill, there are a number of the Royal Engineers buildings on that site. And here we have a closer view of the same picture, and you can see that there were Royal Engineer buildings remaining at that time. Now, from some accounts we get, there was a move at one time to save one of these buildings so that it would be a museum piece in recognition of the work of the Royal Engineers, but the project was left too long and the building was simply too rotten by the time the group got around to trying to save one of the buildings. Now, I included this building and picture of the BC Penitentiary, not necessarily for that particular view, although this is the view where the Royal Engineers camp was, but just on the right of your screen, and not that clear in this picture, there is a group of buildings just in the darkness at that point. Those again are Royal Engineers buildings, and this is the first train to come into Westminster, so this picture is 1887-1888, so you can see that there are still Royal Engineers buildings here over 20 years after the Royal Engineers have left. Back to the downtown area, and just a reminder that the Royal Engineers were very much involved with the development of the city, the planning. They aided in planning in other towns in the province. They were well known for their work. In this case, not referring now to just the general layout of the city, but right in the center of the screen you can just see a little twin-gabled building that was the Royal Columbian Hospital. And they took an active part in the development of that, and when they left a medicine chest full of material, two medicine chests actually, and these formed the nucleus of the Royal Columbian Hospital. In downtown New Westminster, the engineers who stayed on after the group disbanded took an active part in downtown. They were involved in business, and they were pillars of the society at that time. Just on the right of your screen, you see the Hayek Fire Hall. A number of Royal Engineers were involved with that early service. A picture of a rifle team. This is a rifle match of local New Westminster people with a Navy team. In this group are Royal Engineers. We see here the Hayek Anvil Battery, and you can see that these men are military. You get that feeling from this. It's really interesting to look at pictures of these early Anvil Battery groups, and you can see that a number of them have definite military bearing to them. Within the early group were Royal Engineers. One of the most prized pictures of the engineers, this is one called The Survivors of the Thames City. These are Royal Engineers in very much their later years who posed at a reunion dedicated to the work that they had done. Now, I mentioned medicine chests. This is one of the chests, and this particular one is on view at the New Westminster Museum. And just in terms of a last picture to the Royal Engineers is a photograph here showing part of that display at the New Westminster Museum, which gives you a very clear idea of all the work they did, the maps they were involved in, and the feelings that the community had for them. The Royal Engineers were involved in a great many activities in the province of British Columbia, as it's now known. There's no way we could cover it all in such a short program, but you should at least get from it that a lot of what we now have and we take for granted was laid out by this group of men who came from England in 1858 and 1859, and they did a great deal for the province and especially for the city of New Westminster.
As we've seen from the photographs, the Royal Engineers camp was a rather impressive sight. This cairn was placed here in 1980 to mark the survey base that was used in this area. It's interesting to note that in the photographs you've seen of the overall camp, you've noticed a flagpole close to the front of the photographs. This is very close to where this cairn is today. It gives you an idea of how the camp used to sit on this piece of property. It gives you a good idea of the way things change. It's interesting to note when you sit close to this particular monument and look out over the river, to try to imagine the situation where you're sitting down in front of the front row of houses, the officers' quarters, along toward that direction up Columbia Street toward the Patella Bridge was Colonel Moody's residence. Really a wonderful spot to be. You wouldn't have heard the traffic. You would have heard an occasional horse. It was a good spot. People would have gone across in front of you on the way from New Westminster to the outlying community of that time of Sapperton and back and forth. There was a church in Sapperton, for instance, that some of the people from New Westminster proper would have gone out to. So if we were here on a Sunday morning, you would have heard buggies going by as the people went to church, a quiet and wonderful thing to do in front of a camp with its interesting buildings, along a river on which all you saw was an occasional Indian in a canoe. Really a different situation than what we have today. This is probably one of the most interesting spots that New Westminster and British Columbia, for that matter, have to offer. It's an interesting spot, and with all the discussions on what's going to become of the BC Penitentiary now that it's closed, it may even become a more interesting spot in the future.